While there were always rogue filmmakers and cinematographers who experimented with visual ideas, you could point to one film and one pairing of director and cameraman that began to change everything. Citizen Kane, directed by Orson Welles and shot by Greg Toland. Made in the studio system, but with virtually no respect for convention or standards of any kind.
Be careful, Charles!
Kane still stands as one of the most compositionally creative films ever made, and one that woke the world up to the potential of depth in the frame.
Mr. Leland and Mr. Kane, they haven't spoken together for years.
Welles was the kind of filmmaker who believed every shot should show us something new. And Toland was ripe for the challenge. Talk about corridors of vision. With its famous high-angle shots, layers of action, deep focus, and shadowy profusion of style, Kane is a vision of one man's psyche, corrupted by wealth and tortured by loneliness. It's a textbook of how to make composition and depth express a film's meaning, and it's an endless source of inspiration. Here's a famous example. Look at how the dramatic power of the scene is inherent in the extreme composition, complete with the third man, friend to the other two, watching in the doorway far away. In the story, this is a moment of crisis.
Hello, Jedediah.
The final collapse of a lifelong friendship.
Hello, Charlie. I didn't know we were speaking. Sure we're speaking, Jedediah.
All of it is in focus, all in one shot.
You're fired.
Capturing the characters' dynamics and the space they share, as dark and shadowy as a tomb. Think about how another filmmaker would have done it, chopped it up into mundane, standard shots. The sense of watching things happen all at once would be lost. Part of what Kane did was co-opt the shadowy, angular compositions from German Expressionism's silent heyday, and it did it to express the inner turmoil and spiritual sickness of its protagonist, a flamboyant millionaire, forever in search of love and meaning. It's interesting what happened next. Kane's menacing compositions and high contrast lighting were re-co-opted by the crime films of the 40s and 50s, later known as film noir.
Hi, wise guy, drive where I tell you.
In these famous films, the style of expressionism became a way of looking at post-war society as being sick in its soul and without hope. That is, the compositional style went from expressing a subjective point of view, specific to a character's inner life, to being a zeitgeist, an objective way of seeing the modern world.
They got Al.
Here's a famous example of Kane's influence in a great film shot 5 years later by Toland. The film follows three veterans after they return to their small town after World War II. And here, the three exist on different planes in the same shot. As the impaired vet, Harold Russell, plays the piano in the foreground, Frederick March's anxious middle-aged banker pretends to listen as he watches the third man, Dana Andrews, in the rear of the shot, making the phone call that will end his relationship with March's daughter. Look at that shot. An entire drama unfolds without dialogue beneath the piano music, created by the composition's triangulated tension.
Did your man say he ran to the door?
Pushed by Welles' achievement and fueled by important films, Hollywood practice became more creative and dynamic as the years went on. As you can see in this superb courtroom drama, Sidney Lumet's 12 Angry Men.
But you remembered everything. Don't you remember that?
No. Mr. Foreman, I'd like to see a diagram of the apartment.
There are a dozen characters and only one room. You can imagine the challenges, scene by scene, that Lumet and his director of photography, Boris Kaufman, faced. What they did was use the room's depth, accentuate the claustrophobic, keep the spatial relationships clear, and pack the frame with rich characterization.
He said 20 seconds. What are you trying to distort?
He said 15.
American films in general started getting more experimental. Even Westerns, the industry's stock and trade, began exploring space in fresh ways and making composition tell the story instead of dialogue. This is Monty Hellman's masterful existentialist indie, The Shooting. Kane was not a hit in 1941, but its eventual influence was immense, especially among filmmakers and especially in Europe. And in its wake, the post-war years saw a surge in filmmaking creativity on all fronts. How to compose images, how to fill the three-dimensional space, and fully take advantage of the possibilities allowed only by movies, became a central question, explored by some of the greatest filmmakers the medium has ever had.